Hi, good evening everyone, and welcome to Voices Today Tonight. This is our regular pre-show chat. We're going to ease into the topic right now and get to specific issues later, so feel free to warm up as we discuss some of the starting points. What we'll do first is my co-host Will Xavier will make sure that everyone gets to know each other.
Yes. You can see how the people at Google Hangout doing. Nice bright picture you have there, Amos. Say hello, Amos.
Hello.
Amos, everyone say hello to Amos. Amos is a social sciences student. Also at Hangout today, it's time to say hi to Philip Chu. It says here, perhaps Singapore's oldest blogger in Singapore, right? Singapore's oldest blogger parts of Batam.
And some say JB and Batam,
JB
too.
JB and Batam as well. Apparently, we know that Chu Joo Chiat, yes, that Joo Chiat, of Joo Chiat Road and Joo Chiat Place fame, is Philip's great-grandfather. What did you know about him, Philip?
Oh, he came to Singapore in 1877 without a cent in his pocket. Mm-hmm. Mm. And then he died in 1926, a millionaire. So he had a humble beginning.
Right.
So there's still hope for the rest of us, I think.
You'll probably be able to hear voices in the studio with us as well, other than Derek and myself. Director of the Singapore Memory Project is sitting to my left, Gene Tan. Can everyone hear Gene?
Hi, how are you?
You hear that? Guys?
Yes. Yeah,
okay.
Yes.
Also a historian and president of Singapore Heritage Society, Dr. Chua Ailin, is in studio with us. Ailin, nice to have you on board today.
Thank you for
having
me.
Everyone here hearing Ailin?
Hi there.
Yeah. Hello. Yes.
Okay, that's good. So let's get into it. I think one of the reasons why we are tackling this issue is because a lot has been happening recently. The Little India Riot, the spat with Indonesia over the naming of their warship. And I must say, as Voices editor, we were getting more heritage letters. The battle between conservation and development has been something that's going on. We've got the Singapore Memory Project, Gene, which you're in charge of. There are bloggers like Philip. There are new trails. Does it seem to everyone that there is a revival of interest or passion in history?
Mm. What's your take on that, Gene?
Oh, I definitely think so. I see a lot more anxiety about the past now, and there's a longing for people to go back and remember things in their own way. I like to think of it as their own way because I think the interpretations of the past and the projects have emerged, even with the Singapore Memory Project, have been so different and so interesting. Perhaps in place of big history memory, we've been looking at a lot of personal history. People remember the past now, I think, not so much as a national past so much, but as almost like a personal past. So a lot of smaller stories are emerging right now, which are very, very fascinating.
Yes. How did the interesting historical milestones and our relationship with those sort of coincides with the 50th anniversary coming up? Nice round number, nice time to taking stock. You think there's a lot of interest because of the upcoming 50th anniversary, perhaps?
I guess there are a lot of initiatives, especially government initiatives, to encourage people to celebrate the 50th anniversary. Like with the Singapore Memory Project as well, we've also got funding for community projects and there's a whole Singapore 50 fund for that. So I think that that's really encouraged the people to find ways to commemorate the anniversary in their own way, in addition to the government celebrations that will take place.
Amos, you are on the ground as a social sciences student, beyond the academic aspect of it. With the Singapore 50 Project, as Ailin said, is there the response to this initiative?
From the ground? Actually, not really.
Why do you say that? Do you say that because that has been the response of your peers, they're not interested, or is there another basis to why you think that way?
I think many of my peers haven't really heard about it, and the people who are more concerned tend to be older at the moment. Yeah.
Philip, I think you're probably one of those that Amos is referring to. Do you have a different take?
Because I go on Facebook and then I posted a lot of old photographs, and then the response was very good.
Yeah, it appears also that in your case, because you happen to be related to someone, a historical figure. What about man in the street? Do you think they're interested as much
oh,
as
no,
you are?
I not only on my blog about Jujia, Facebook, I posted photos of places like Pasir Ris, Julia Street, those the building, and then they are very interested. They can describe, you know, especially the older one, they can remember, but the younger one, they also try to pitch in to tell the story of the place.
Scenes of the past, Amos, is that something that the younger generation who has grown up in an age where development in Singapore has been pretty rapid, you know, you go away for 1 year, you come back, Singapore might look slightly different. Scenes of the past, is that something that can resonate with the younger generation to know a country that they live in looked different before?
Yes, I think it is one thing that the youth can connect to as we have grown up in the era where it has developed very quickly. And we can still discuss, for example, the old playgrounds that we used to have, the ones that resemble dragons and elephants, and it does give us a sense of nostalgia.
I remember a stone duck on a spring. And a sort of a carousel, which you know, with rotting wood benches, those sorts of things. You pick pictures of those things because these things no longer exist. Amos, needs to be captured by the technology available to us. I'm very impressed by the fact that you know that Philip just got on board with the technology, goes straight into the blogs. Whether he knew too much about you know, uploading this sort of information, a lot of the pictures and the stories are largely inaccessible because they sit in very unusable form, for example. So digitizing pictures and getting up on the internet is part of the way to bring that into the mainstream so everyone can have a look at it. Do you agree? Amos?
Yeah. I have to do
I'll go ahead,
research and then get the photographs digitized and put them together in my blog so that especially the past and present, so that people can tell in the old days how it looked like and now how it has improved.
You think people your age are more interested in this than the people Amos's age?
Oh, of course, people of my age, they are more keen because they can relate to it. Whereas Amos' age people, I don't think so.
Amos, you do think that nostalgia is something, is a value or a trait that the young would fit into as a description, or are the young just always looking forward, moving from one technology or one game to another?
I think nostalgia plays a very big part of our growth. And for example, when you mentioned about technology and gaming, when we play the Xbox now, we used to comment, we still comment on like the first Game Boy we ever owned and all those. So yeah, and it bonds us together.
Gene, whenever we visit places of interest, we are asked to leave nothing but footprints and take nothing but pictures or memories away with us. What's the motivation for capturing what you've managed to get so far with the Memory Project?
To a large extent, it's actually capturing the people that you experience those with and the relationships that you therefore remember. We find that the most powerful memories of ordinary objects of the past is when there is a love story, there is a parent, there is a very good friend involved. In fact, one of the most popular stories we had posted on Facebook is of the orange coin box. So we had tons of stories of people who were talking to their future wives when they were in the army, putting little coins inside. And it is just phenomenal. It went viral. And people got very excited recounting their past by remembering all the people that they walked through.
When we get onto the air on Channel 5, I want to come back to the orange box story. Tell us more about that in detail. Aline, what is your job made easier or harder because the people who have the stories and the oral tradition may die out with the people with that generation? What's the best way to make sure that this stuff doesn't fade away? Well, and not just memories remain.
I think there's, as you pointed out, there's a growing interest now.
Yeah.
And as Mr. Chu says, all the stuff that's going on Facebook. So I think there are actually two initiatives or really movements to collect these stories and memories. Mm-hmm. One's coming from institutions like the National Library, which has the Singapore Memory Project, and the Oral History Centre, which has been collecting interviews since 1979. They've got thousands of interviews there. And then now you see the people spontaneously sharing what they know, bringing out their old photos from their storerooms and putting them on Facebook. Mm-hmm. There are some very, very active Facebook groups like On a Little Street in Singapore or Nostalgia Singapore. They've got 4,000 or 5,000 members and they're so active. Mm-hmm. And the moment someone puts up one old photograph, you can see tons and tons of comments, people connecting with it and sharing their own memories or stories around similar things.
Yeah. We'll come back and talk about whether you could coordinate all those efforts in a better way. Meantime, I want everyone to hold their fire. We're going live to Channel 5 in about 2 or 3 minutes. Please stay right there. And when we come back to you, please jump in if you want to make a comment or respond to something that you're hearing from one of your fellow panel members today. And keep your comments nice and sweet and nice and lively, okay? I like that smile, Philip.
Thank you.
Yeah, and keep the laughter going.
And if there's anything that you heard in this pre-show and you want to raise it and build on it, go ahead when we come to you in the live show.
We're bus enthusiasts. We take photographs. We collect memorabilia such as tickets, destination plates, and even the hubcaps and the display signs.
The little things like the sound of the bells, people would remember 10, 20, maybe 30 years down.
So unlike these youth, do other Singaporeans know or care about our past?
We've been reminded recently, though, that history isn't dead. When Indonesia named a warship after two Marines who bombed McDonald House in the 1960s.
But is the past relevant to us today? And as Singapore turns 50, do we really have a common collective memory?
Find out on Voices Today, starting right now.
Good evening and welcome to Voices Today. I'm Derek Paolo and next to me is probably a man who's more of history than I am.
Well, you're about to say historical character, weren't you?
No.
Okay, I'm going to give you to the end of this show to tell me who said, the farther backward you can look, the farther forward you are likely to see.
Okay, I'll think about it.
With that in mind, same question for the guests we have on the set with us. Among them, Jean Tan to my left, director of the Singapore Memory Project. You brought some photos and memories of ordinary Singaporeans you'll be able to share with us later.
Yes,
welcome.
Be happy to.
Dr. Chua Ai Lin, our other guest, is a historian and president of the Singapore Heritage Society. Dr. Chua, thank you for being here with us.
The ghosts of history have been surfacing recently. The Little India Riot, for example, was the first in Singapore for over 40 years since the 1969 racial riots.
And earlier this month, tensions arose between Singapore and Jakarta when Indonesia named a warship after two Marines who were hung for the 1965 bombing of McDonald House. Defence Minister Ng Eng Hen was referring to the ship and said, it's reopening old wounds and carrying the weight of the dark history of confrontasi.
As Singapore turns 50 next year and we pay tribute to the pioneer generation, we can expect more stories from yesteryear to resurface. But does the past really matter? Call us to share your views on air at 669-11020.
You can also tweet us, of course, with the hashtag VoicesToday and post your views at tdy.sg/VoicesToday. Joining us tonight by way of Google Hangout, welcome Philip Chu, who is perhaps Singapore's oldest blogger after me, I think. He blogs about his great-grandfather, Chu Juchiat. Yes, that Juchiat and other memories. Hi, Philip.
Hi.
Amos Maximilian Lee is joining us as well at the Hangout, a social sciences student. Hello, Amos.
Hi.
Well, let's get the ball rolling then with our youngest participant, Amos, with the question, how much do younger Singaporeans, including those in their 20s and 30s, know or indeed care about Singapore's past?
I think many Singaporeans around my age are losing their memories of the past. Because of the turbulent nature of our present economy, and we are more concerned with our future, like the potential jobs, housing, and a whole range of other issues. And it's because of this insecurity that makes us more anxious and looking toward the future.
Is that a concern for you, Jean, in charge of the, you know, memory project, that Amos says younger Singaporeans are losing their memories?
A lot of younger Singaporeans need something with personality to hold on to. And we find that when the past has a personality, when that emerges, they are able to connect to that. It takes a little bit more work, but we are beginning to find that there are many groups of young people, including the bus maniacs that you saw just now, that we unearthed with the project, that have begun to find interesting ways to look at the past.
Yeah. Is it true though, Island, that the 20s, people in their 20s and 30s are any more or less interested, and what really are they interested in?
Well, I think more and more young people are getting interested, and it's partly the changes that we see around us that, that's prompting this. I teach history at the National University of Singapore, and I find more students being interested in my Singapore history courses, partly because they're very struck by the rapid change of the landscape, and they do feel nostalgia. In our earlier chat with Amos, he was saying that even young people feel nostalgia for what they've experienced in their own lives.
Many 20s people in their 20s and 30s are very active in the social media, and it's also interesting at this point to look at the social media conversations that our friends at DDB have been harvesting on our behalf. This chart, as you can see, looks at words most frequently mentioned in some 600 conversations in the past 30 days. Two topics in particular were trending. What do you make of tours launched this month of the Marsiling tunnels, which were used by the British and Japanese forces during World War II, and shame on you if you didn't know these things existed, and a tweak to the history syllabus in schools, which will cover more of Singapore's history before the 1800s. More about that later. So, it looks like there are some people who are strongly passionate about our heritage and history. Island and Philip, you are two of them. Coming to you first, Dr. Chua, why is it important that the past should be not just preserved, but passed on?
Well, I think the past gives us a perspective on the present and the future, so that we can see things in the light of what's happened before. But I think what the past is important because it shows us, it teaches us to look at things in context, that we understand different contexts of what things were like before and today. I think it gives us better critical thinking skills to look at our own lives with.
Can you translate that into something that is happening now, where the role of history helps us to think better about an issue?
Jean, would you have any suggestions on that?
I think a lot of people lose the concept of the person around stories and big issues like that. When you look at the confrontation, you think of it as perhaps a diplomatic issue, maybe a national issue, but actually at the heart of it, it is a personal issue. So when you hear stories of how a whole family was actually becoming a family of orphans, we realize the impact that it has. So the different angles to history from the perspective of the personal and the individual is something that we lose when we look at the past just with huge lenses.
Yeah. Is that what you mean by giving the past personality when you tell these stories?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, giving that an emotional connection. I think people tend to look at the past in a dispassionate way. I think we should have a movement to look at the past through the lenses of the people who lived through it.
Yeah. Would you go along with that, Philip?
Yes, but I feel that only those who are affected, like the families and relatives, will relate better. For example, the war memorial, every year the relatives and the friends of those who were killed by the Japanese, they were there to pay respect.
I was asking you a while ago about whether people like yourself who have a historical figure or an interesting story that you can tell may gather more, may get more attention or have a better sense of history other than the folks who, you know, my granddad was just Joe something.
Well, my story is about my great-grandfather, Chu Chu Chen. So he had a humble beginning And so I want my his descendants as well as my family members to know about that.
Yeah.
He died a millionaire, but he still keep a very low profile. Mm-hmm. So much so that the people, most of them today, didn't even know that he was a early pioneer in Singapore. Mm. So he was not listed in the name of those buried in Bukit Brown. Mm. And then also the Singapore Hokkien Association in 2012, June, I think, they announced that they're going to write a book of 150 Singapore Hokkien pioneers.
Mm.
And then I checked, his name also not in there. So right. I got to intervene and tell the both sides that, hey, Juche is an early pioneer, you better include their names.
Right.
So they were in.
Yeah. It's a good thing we have you both on the show today, as well as you're still around to be able to pass the story on. And before you disappear altogether, we better have somebody write all this down, I think. Tell us what you think by taking our poll. It's time for us to take a break right now. And we want to ask, how important is it that we know about Singapore's history? We're going to take a break. And when we come back, how can history be made more relevant to a new generation? Looking at you, Amos. Tweet us your views, of course, and call us, continue to call us at 669-11020 to share with us on the air. Don't go away. Voices Today, we'll be right back.
We've got our first caller on the show tonight, Mohammed Alim. You have a point to make about why you think history isn't all that important.
Yeah, but if everybody trying to talk about history, so what's going to happen about the future? Some of it, yeah, do really matter, lah. You know, but like the bombing one, all this kind of thing, I don't think people should remember, lah.
Why not?
Why not? That is a very painful history to be reminded of, you know. And someone like for me, it's like, yeah, we have just to move on. The history, the good part of the history should keep, and the bad part for me is like, just leave it and we move on. No point bringing up the past. If we are going to bring up the past, what's going to happen in Singapore future?
Yes.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Alim.
I'm sure it's about lessons, is it not? That, you know, those who do not, you know, learn the lessons of history are condemned to repeat them. Lessons learned. Clearly, that must be a response to Alim's remarks.
Oh, absolutely. And I think the past has so many lessons, but also the past has so many details that we could look at. Just looking at the bombing itself, the efforts to pull through that. We talk about the Singapore spirit and going through adversity or different situations. The individuals who pulled together and continued to ensure that Singapore is able to go on. I think those are stories that will motivate us to go on to the future.
I think that Alim was right in that, you know, that was a painful part of our history. And I think what some ordinary Singaporeans are celebrating, as far as heritage goes, is less painful, more pleasant, and they're doing it in different and unusual ways. Take this group of youth, for instance, who love taking a bus trip to the past.
Please move to the rear for the benefit of boarding passengers.
We take photographs, we collect memorabilia such as tickets, destination plates, and even the hubcaps and the display signs.
Please do not leave your belongings behind.
Not every model of the buses are same. Each bus is different in their own way.
So we photograph buses, is able to help the current generation be able to remember their old times on how the buses were like. They were having wooden seats, or there's a ticket inspector on board.
There are many ways that we can get memories of buses. For example, the bus bell. You press it, but we may not notice that it could be a memory. But 10 years, 20 years down, when we recall back, that sound is very distinctive. You can remember it a second that, hey, I used to be in that bus. Or you're at night, you're seeing the old bus coming in, you're using those plastic signs and trying to read what number is it, because it's too hard to see. In the future, it's all electronic signs. So these small things can actually give a big impact to the history of this whole country, Singapore.
Well, that was an interesting group of youth. I think other ground-up efforts to record and pass on memories of Singapore include blogs like yesterday.sg and myqueenstown.blogspot. Amos, I'm going to go to you right now to ask, what will it take to engage your generation in Singapore's past?
I think what we need to do is to have to adjust the way we teach history by integrating a Singaporean history into our current syllabus. Because right now, we are focusing on the World Wars and the Cold Wars. However, I think many of us don't really connect with what we learn. And I think that adding a Singaporean history part would make us understand our own country better. And recently, MOE announced that they will be teaching Singapore history as far back as the 14th century. And however, I feel that even though it's a good move, they should focus more on what I call the pioneer settlers period, which in relation to Philip are the early Singaporeans, such as Aljunied, Yunos, Nee Soon, and Tan Tock Seng. And this era is important, I think, because they are the personalities that helped to contribute to Singapore society in the past.
Right. Island, Amos talked about content. How about the way history is taught? Is it a question, do you know, if it's been taught in a very boring way that our youth are not interested in it?
Quite possibly.
Philip, I'm sorry, I'm going to go to Island to get this answer.
Well, I'm not sure what the previous syllabus looked like, but I've seen the new textbook, and I think it's really interesting. I think it's a wonderful attempt to teach Singapore history, for example, through place names. So it's something that you can connect with because we often walk past these places, like with Mr. Chu's great-grandfather, Ju Chiet, but we never stop to think, who is Ju Chiet? What's the history there? So the new syllabus really takes people into history through this very interesting way which they can connect. I think it's a great move. Yeah.
Is history or has history ever been compulsory?
I think lower secondary, they have to learn history. Mm-hmm. Mm.
Does it send the wrong signal, Philip, if, for example, you know, we dispense with history at some level and then just stick to the core subjects? It gives people the impression that it's not really that important, agreeing with our caller from before. When you pick up that point, Philip, how important is teaching of history?
Yes, history is very important. Because during my time, there was during the British time, I learned British Empire history. So I also know about the War of American Independence. So when I went to England, I can relate with the building there, the castles, the Thames and whatnot. It was all mentioned in the book. So it's very, what do you call sentimental, especially when I only read in the book and then go there, able to see exactly what is in the book,
right? Taking history beyond the book, that's one thing that one documentary which is airing right now is doing, Channel News Asia's Days of Rage documentary series, which you can catch tonight on Channel 5 at 10:30, covered events such as the Maria Hertog riots and Confrontasi with archival footage and eyewitness accounts. Today reviewer Mei Xia said it makes these distant, briefly chronicled events in our textbooks real by telling the personal stories of real people. Jean, how can history come alive in the classroom?
I think stories telling as well as story making would be a huge part of that. Mm. I always find that teaching, when it takes a very one-way traffic method, doesn't sink in. So having participation, having the students make history on their own to create history and to be able to represent it in interesting ways will be quite fascinating.
Amos, did you look into the front of the classroom and see your history teacher dressed as Stamford Raffles at any point in your school career?
I wish I did. I wish they did. But I had really great history teachers, and I think what makes the impact is the passion that it showed in the subject they teach.
Until we get to that point, I'm sure the attitude of the teacher is a little bit more important right now than the attitude of the student until we know what that is. Based on social media sentiment, however, most people we know, 65%, think that history is interesting or important, thank goodness. Meanwhile, another survey by the young Singaporeans behind the campaign Avenue 1960s, your old friend Jean, finds that 85% think history is important. However, only 15% would seek out info on it. So, does history have to be retold in a different way? I'll get my Stamford Raffles costume right away. For a younger generation, say, if you said to anyone, the Singapore story, and you think of the official narrative of the founding leaders of Singapore. But is that narrative shifting? Are there more storytellers? Jean, you've been quoted as saying, history is not just for the leaders, it's about random people too. Who are they and have you met them?
Yes, I've met so many of them. I am determined for the Singapore Memory Project not to look at specific types to fill up history. We're looking at people who would be random folks who walk past.
Yeah.
The Singapore Memory Project, and in unearthing the stories, yes, we find very specific details,
yes,
of someone that you might find unremarkable.
I wanted you to tell us briefly the story of Diana Rahim. What immediately comes to mind?
Oh, that's amazing. This is a story of her grandmother, and she married when she was 14, 15 years younger than her husband. It was an arranged marriage. She actually went through the racial riots in the middle of her marriage. So she's 14 years old, she's terrified of entering a marriage.
Yes.
And she was faced with this huge incident. So it was a story that the grandmother took a very long time to tell because she didn't think it was important.
Right.
So these are the stories that we want to unearth for the Singapore Memory Project.
Yeah, the physical remains of notable buildings, for example. You tell a story about the now defunct Alhambra Cinema at Beach Road and the story of Eric Lim. What did he say?
Oh, he said that that was a place where his mom was proposed to by his father. And that was the first time they ever went to the cinema.
Right.
The place is no more, but they've been married for 50 years.
Yes, the movie date was the date back in the day, wasn't it?
Do people
look at it a different way these days?
I think so too. I think for people, they feel that when they look back at the past through the eyes of their parents and through something like a love story, I think the past really needs to be romanticized to reach out to the younger generation.
Yeah, and not just the facts and figures on a page, but you know, the history being like, you know, the way my parents met each other, matters of the heart, those connect really well.
Yes, and I think actually that's just the starting point, because that's when people start to understand history more deeply. Once they've been brought in by the personal stories, then they may ask further questions. And I think then it's giving them the tools to know where to look for the answers to those questions. And that's very empowering, because the history just doesn't come from the textbook, but you can go out and search for the history yourself.
Talking about going out to search for history, is the disappearance of a lot of the physical memories of Singapore something that will affect our connection with our past?
Definitely.
You have about 30 seconds.
Okay. Well, I think one of the questions that you want to ask is about connecting across different generations. And it's really if those physical landscape is there, it gives different generations the same touch point to connect with. So I think that's very important that those don't change too fast if we want to talk about the continuity from one generation to the next.
And yes or no, when these things disappear, you think there's not enough debate as to people, you know, sticking their hand up and saying, you know, please don't take that away because it's our history. You mustn't do that.
Well, I think we need better heritage impact assessment studies before we change the landscape.
Yeah. Philip, you laughed just now. You resonate with what Will just said?
No, it's about the physical heritage. It should not be disappear. See, like Bukit Brown.
Yeah. Right.
So many pioneers were there.
Correct.
And then if you remove them, everything will be forgotten. Eh?
So basically, you do agree with what Eileen said. I think we have some agreement in terms of like the physical structure. On the other hand, you have a debate on what kind of history do you want to tell? Personal histories or the official history? That's something to think about. Whether history is important, tell us what you think on our poll on our website, tdy.sg/voicestoday.
Take part in the poll, of course, and email your views right to this guy especially, the Today's Voices pages. Time for us to say thanks very much to all our guests today in the studio as well as online. Time for us to say history is a lesson that we can all learn. We'll see you next Thursday for another live debate right here on Voices Today. Say goodbye, everyone. Thanks for being here. Absolutely. I think we made history today. See you next time.
Have a good night.
Welcome back. The discussion continues right here on Voices Today, and we've got a caller on the line. Francis, you want to share your views on this issue?
Francis?
Francis on the line?
You're joining us on telephone. Go ahead, Francis. We're trying to re-establish your contact with Francis. Why don't you start and tell us what we missed about that story with the coins and the orange boxes. What was it about?
Oh, we had a Facebooker who actually posted on our page, so we decided to share that with a wider audience. Yeah. So people started to put in stories about how they would collect little coins here and there and accumulate them so that when they were in the army, they could call their girlfriends. But there was a particular love story of a person who talked about how he sustained his relationship through all these 10-cent coins in the orange coin box in the army. Mm-hmm. And that lady that he spoke to later became his wife. And it's still his wife.
Orange coin box means the orange coiner phone type.
Yes, the coin box phone.
Right, this is long before cell phones or those brick mobiles, right? You couldn't get to a phone back then.
So it's more sincere to make a phone call through that than through a handphone because it takes effort.
We've got Gary on the line. And Gary, this topic means something a bit more to you because your dad is one of the pioneer generation. What do you think about tonight's discussion so far?
Yes, that's right. Firstly, thanks for having me on the program. So I think history needs to be taken in context. So if it's being used to inform and educate and help people shape their decisions that will dictate their future, then yes, it's a very important tool. And certainly we can learn a lot from the pioneer generation and the lessons they've obviously taught us in building this nation. But on the flip side, if history is used as sort of a crutch on which we lean because we want to hark back to the good old days and you know, we don't want to let go of the past, then that's very difficult for Singapore to progress. So in that respect, it becomes a stumbling block. So I feel that history, depending on how you treat it, could have different outcomes.
Right. Are you talking about something specific that you can use as an example and see whether the crutch mentality prevails over here?
Sure. So obviously we've heard conversations, right, and flippant remarks by people when they say, the buses weren't so crowded, there weren't so many foreigners, cars were cheaper, the roads were less busy, the air was cleaner, why are there so many people? And obviously with the whole population white paper, there was a lot of debate about how back in the 60s it was never this crowded. So I think people need to realize that this is progress, this is the 21st century, and if we keep thinking back to how good times used to be, then I don't think we are letting ourselves move forward. And this actually hinders the progress of this nation. So I feel that then becomes a bad thing.
Nothing wrong with that, any of that being true, is it, Island?
Well, I think there's different aspects of history, and maybe what Gary is referring to is a sense of nostalgia, and that's usually looking back on the golden age of the past.
Yeah.
And earlier we had another caller who talked about the past being something traumatic, so it's a very different way of looking back on the past. And for me as an academic, probably I see history as something being more about learning about information. Mm. So there are lots of different ways to think about the past, and as Gary said, they have different outcomes.
Mm. Yes, we'd like to thank Gary for that interesting point, and it builds on something what Amos said. So I'm going to go to you, Amos, right now. You mentioned earlier that because the youth are living in a time of rapid social change, this is why history has become a bit more important. So what do you make of Gary's point that, you know, we, on the other hand, shouldn't be looking back so much at the past and how it used to be?
I think that we should look back in the past so that we can have a sense of appreciation of what we have now. I mean, every generation has its own set of problems, but we can be thankful that we have been better now than the past. For example, in life expectancy and literacy rate.
Right.
Yeah, I think you mentioned that when you posted on our website. But do you think, on the other hand, that because we always expect to improve, if we always think of how
much better it is now, then we're not able to move forward as fast as we could.
I think it's fine balance between looking at the past and looking towards the future, and it's very subjective.
I was very curious to know that while one group of people who have a special interest in preserving the history, some of whom are joining us on the set, Philip, what problems do you have getting the stories right, and can you expand the scope of what you do with your blog to tell more stories or to get more people interested by saying, you know what, parents, please tell your children these stories. It can't just be down to myself and some interested parties. Every story is an important one. Can you say that?
Yeah, I agree. Everybody has a story to tell. For my case, of course, happened to be Chiu Chiu Chiat, who is my root. And then, of course, I want his descendants to know his humble beginning. And that he kept a very low profile, so much so that nobody knows he is one of Singapore's early pioneers.
I think we've been talking about stories, you know, from the personal point of view. Gene, especially, you believe a lot in this. At the same time, is there a need at all to have a common memory of what route we went through and where we're heading?
In fact, I think the collective sentiment that comes from all these stories is actually quite instructive. If I may go back to your question earlier about how the past could hinder the future, I think the past currently, shockingly, is slowing us down in a very good way. When we look back at the things that we love in the past, and I know the Kampung spirits have said a lot, we can't get that back. But that talk of inclusiveness or pulling people together has actually made us now, in the present, more conscious about those who we need to include and pay attention to. So I think the past can actually slow us down in a very, very powerful way.
Do you think, Gary, if you're with us still, do you think that efforts that are being made in this regard are both dedicated as well as coordinated and you know, widespread among the general population?
So to answer the question, yes, I still think more can be done. And actually, I do agree with Jean when she says that the past actually can slow us down in positive ways. So an image just came to my mind. So this is something that a friend told me about. So you look at pictures in the past of how Lee Kuan Yew used to sit with his cabinet ministers, and there would be a Malay, an Indian, a Chinese, and they would all sup together. And that was the norm. But nowadays, people, you know, have their own little groups, and they're all going in different directions. And if we look to that and talk about, again, the inclusiveness and the Kampung spirit that Jean talked about, then yes, maybe those things will help us to take a step back. You know what? Maybe society should still be like this, even in the 21st century. So I think that's a good point. Now, about the coordinated efforts, like you said, there was an earlier discussion on the program about whether or not it should be taught in schools. Might I hazard a suggestion and say that if it's an examinable subject, then maybe people would take a keener interest? That may come across as a bit cynical, but again, if you really want to educate and drum it into the heads of our youngsters today, then maybe a bit of force is required, rather than just having it out there on websites for people to go at their own time and leisure.
Never mind multiple choice or Q&A. How about making it an examinable subject and it must be practical in its application? Would you go for that?
I think Amos also brought up a point where it's now being integrated into the syllabus, and even Eileen, who teaches history, surely she has her views on how it can be made compulsory in a way where people then take a definitive interest in the subject rather than, you know, think about it casually.
I get a sense that beyond the school book or beyond Philip's blog, stuff rather than just stories, you know,
project
relics,
work.
Project work, you know, and the museums should be full, shouldn't they?
I think it should be about experiencing the past and beyond the textbooks as what was discussed. And
how well do you think we're doing in that regard?
Better. I think we're getting better at it, but I wouldn't go with the idea of making it compulsory for doing the exam route, because I think that turns people off.
Yeah.
I'm more interested in getting people to see it in a fun way, to connect with it. And I think that the landscape is very powerful. Mm. For example, you know, we're always wondering how to get people interested in history. And I'm very glad that Mr. Chu mentioned Bukit Brown, because for me, that's a story of how a bunch of people who were not terribly interested in history before have been so taken by the place that they've gone out and really educated themselves and become interested in all different aspects of Singapore history because of being introduced to it through visiting a place like Bukit Brown. So that's a very, very powerful experience.
Do you need any more encouragement, Philip, to look with the upcoming 50th anniversary of Singapore's independence?
Yeah, I agree with Chua Eileen. That the people must get experience himself so that they will know what Singapore was before. For example, they should take a trip in a nearby country where certain countries still backward and where Singapore was once like them. Then they will know that, we have come a long way, and not just like, you know, one press button and you flush your toilet and that's all.
That's something I want to bounce off Amos right now, because as part of the younger generation, one of the sentiments perhaps that is on the ground is that, well, you can't expect us to know the past or live in a time when we're less developed because this is all we know. Is there a feeling that when the youth look at stories like this, they say, well, times have moved on?
Mm.
Yes, I think there have been people who don't really think much about history and they say move on.
Yeah.
But I think that there are also a group of people who feel that sense of nostalgia and of the things of the past.
Those who don't necessarily agree with the good old days in all its forms, that we take away flushing toilets and thinking, oh, that's a good thing, you know, let's not give any of that up, you know. Is that the sort of crutch mentality that we were talking about, taking us back, you know, in order to impede progress? I think people are a little smarter than that these days, surely.
Oh, I think so too. I think they look back to the past for all the nice feelings about it, but I think people are clever enough to know that they don't want to have to do nice soil again.
Yes.
That's not something you want to be nostalgic with or to experience again.
The kampung spirit, because of the way houses were designed, for example, there is no physical example of that happening, is there?
Well, I think that you're very right that the design of the landscape shapes how we behave, and the landscape has changed so dramatically. If we want to talk about how social behavior has also altered, maybe we need to look at how that landscape has affected the way in which we interact with each other as well.
Talking about why we look back at the past, one thing that hasn't been discussed yet is our identity, our sense of identity as a nation, our sense of identity as an individual, and as an individual within this society. How is that playing out, Gene, at this point in time, as far as you can see it?
A lot of this is through collective experiences. I feel that people are averse to reducing the Singapore identity or spirit to just a few words or just a few pictures. Mm. But if we can make the Singapore identity a little messier, a little more complex, with something that represents all the minutiae that comes with feeling Singaporean, I think that would sound far more authentic.
Right. Singaporeans don't like messy. That's something I get from the ground. Do you think that part of this search for identity is because we need to have a certain mold in which we say, ha, that's Singaporean?
Well, maybe the mold we've been given so far doesn't reflect that messiness that Jean's talking about, and so not everybody can find their own reflection in that very simplified identity. Yeah. So really, it's finding the ways that you can connect, and we need more different ways in which people can connect to a sense of Singapore.
However, it's evolved, Amos. Do you think that the Singaporean identity has made us mature enough, or we are so ingrained with a sense of identity that we are prepared to look at the past and where things were not exactly right? We've grown. We've come a long way in order to sort out the problems of the past, and in so doing, more united than ever, which is a good thing to have 50 years on, right?
Actually,
we have to look back on history and say we have to look at it, warts and all.
Yes, that's true. However, I don't think we have really decided what the Singaporean identity really is. I think if there's one thing that history has helped us is that it has shown that what are the aspects that can we can incorporate into our Singapore identity. But yeah. I think right now we are still debating and discussing as to what makes the Singaporeans.
Yeah. Yeah. Just one quick follow-up on that, Amos. Do you think the young generation are looking to history for their sense of identity?
Yes, and I think that this history ties very much with our culture and tradition, especially when it comes to food.
Yes. So there are certain touch points, basically. Yeah.
Is there enough? Is there enough diversity built into the system that we don't have to wait another 50 years to look back on our history and think, you know what, we accept it and it's relevant to us the last 50, and not going to take another 50 to us to try and reinterpret history. Your memories may not necessarily coincide with mine, but that's okay. Is it okay?
I think it's not only okay, it should be mandatory to have many, many versions of what the past is like. Yeah. In fact, I hope we are capturing many, many versions of the present so that the future could continue to debate the Singaporean identity.
And the only way for that to happen is for to make sure that everybody knows that their story is important, yes, no matter what it is.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Let's go to Philip for a final thought from him. You've been telling the story of Joo Chiat because you want to tell a story that you know. Are you finding in your interactions as you do this endeavor that others' version of history seems to differ from yours and maybe changes over time?
Talking about Singapore identity, all right? It takes time and then it will do it naturally. For example, when I go overseas, I can spot a Singaporean straight away because it's the way they behave and the way they talk. Okay? Mm. So it takes time for such a character or things to come out.
Luckily for you, we all speak the same way. Thanks very much indeed, everyone. I love the discussion. Thanks for making it nice and lively. And thanks, as always, to all our guests. Another chance for you to catch the show later on this weekend. Meantime, thanks to everybody and the crew and the best show in the business. We'll see you next time.
Good night, everyone.